Dear colleagues, students, would like to start. Keep the door open. It's a wonderful weather outside, but nevertheless, it's a wonderful atmosphere here inside. Having some wonderful people here. Among them, of course, our keynote speaker. I'll introduce him to you in a few seconds. But as the Dean of Tilburg Law School, I am delighted to extend a warm word of welcome first to you all for joining us for this year's Montesquieu lecture to be delivered by Professor Boaventura de Sousa Santos. Welcome to Tilburg. It's a pleasure to have you here. You had a wonderful event yesterday, as I understood, a discussion with the PhD students, which was lively. And we have high expectations as regards to the lecture you're going to give in a few minutes. But let me say a few words about your career and the focus of your work. You're an emeritus professor of sociology at the University of Coimbra in Portugal and a distinguished legal scholar at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. You're also the director of the Center for Social Studies at the University of Coimbra, and you've written and published widely on issues of globalization, sociology of law and the state, epistemology, social movements, human rights, and the World Social Forum. Professor Santos, your research explores, amongst others, the possibilities of counter-hegemonic globalization in response to global capitalism. And in particular, you are interested in recovering the law's emancipatory potential from its collapse. Its collapse given regulation in the framework of transnational governance. And to this effect, you explore in your work and you draw on epistemologies and strands of thinking that have been marginalized by canonical forms of Western modernity. You've been involved in research in many countries around the world, and I've listed here just a few of them, mentioning Brazil, to the other side of the world, Macau, Mozambique, South Africa, Colombia, Bolivia, and India. And you're one of the driving forces behind, as I said, the World Social Forum. Ladies and gentlemen, the spirit of the World Social Forum is essential to your studies of counter-hegemonic globalization and to promoting the struggle for global cognitive justice and the underlying concept of epistemologies in the South. Professor Santos, your contributions to these issues have earned you an honorary doctorate by the University of McGill, and most recently, you have received an ERC, Advanced Grant, with the title, as I understand, ALICE, an acronym for Leading Europe to a New Way of Sharing the World Experiences, if I'm correct, yeah? As I already mentioned yesterday, you gave a masterclass to a group of our research students and PhD researchers, and they had the opportunity to discuss with you an article that you have written, and in particular, your approaches toward the intertwinement of methodology and substantive issues in the study of law. Today, in the Montesquieu lecture, you will offer us insights addressed under the theme, the resilience of abyssal exclusions in our societies towards the post-abyssal law. And this lecture, your lecture, is a warm and welcome contribution to our Montesquieu lectures, which provide, as we all know, a forum for leading legal scholars to reflect on the interface between law and urgent social issues. Again, many thanks for joining us, Professor Santos, and we look forward to your lecture. But before giving you the floor, I would like to introduce the members of the panel, because we have a panel discussion after the keynote speaker. Four members of the panel, and they will discuss with you the central theme of today. I'll introduce to you Henry Swinkels, representative for the Socialist Party at the Gedeputeerde Staten of the province, just to mention in Dutch, the gedeputeerde staten of the provincie Noord-Brabant. Ralf Embrechts, director of a maatschappelijk ontwikkelingsmaatschappij, which is a network, for your information, which is a network tasked with activities and projects to empower dwellers of two neighborhoods in our Tilburg community. Connie Rijke, who is a colleague of mine, professor at our school, and she's a professor specialized in migration law, human trafficking, and European criminal law. And, of course, Nuna Zekic, she is an assistant professor, as we all know her, of law at TLS. And you, Nuna, specialize in dismissal law, collective labor agreements. Many thanks to all four of you for participating in the panel and having, I'm sure, a lively discussion with our keynote speaker. Please feel free to join us afterwards for drink. The drinks are after the panel session. Finally, let me express a word of welcome, thanks, to Anneke Overbos, Jacoba Floor, and Marianne Schoning, I'm not sure where they are, for their great work in providing logistical support for this event. A warm thanks also for Ton Wildhagen for arranging today's panel. And finally, last but not least, Hans Lindahl for his tremendous efforts and support in organizing this lecture, and also given his dedication and enthusiasm, our Montesquieu lecture series is once again an inspiring yearly event that makes me, that makes all of us very proud. Thank you, Hans, for that. Professor De Santos, I'll give you the floor for your keynote lecture.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much, Dan, for such a generous introduction. I'm very glad to be here, and it's my first time in Tilburg, not in Holland. I've been here very often in your country. And with such a warm welcome, I'm really very pleased to be here. And I hope that I'll be useful to the tasks that you have set forward for these lectures and for your school. And I also thank my colleague, Hans Lindahl, for having organized this invitation, and my colleagues here in the panel, which will be a great pleasure for me to share with them some of these ideas. So I'm going to start right away. And then mention that I just finished a very large ERC, European Research Council grant, on Alice in Wonderland. The title is Alice, Alice in Wonderland. And the idea was based on two preposterous premises, that Europe has nothing to teach the world after five centuries having learned and being a professor for the world. I think that Europe should go back to the school of the world, but as a student, not as a professor. Should learn from the experiences of the Global South. But unfortunately, in Europe, still prevails a colonial prejudice to the extent that we don't feel that we could learn anything from the outside world, from non-European world. After all, we are more developed, we have solved all the problems that they are wrestling with, and therefore nothing can be useful coming from there. So this prevents us from learning from the world. And the world today is a fascinating field of innovation, of alternatives, of creativity, which does not reach our news, of course, does not reach our universities most of the time, and doesn't reach our theories, because our theories are sometimes part of an epistemology of blindness. That is to say, they allow us to see certain things, but blind us to see other things. For instance, things that could be valuable, but we don't have the adequate lenses to do that. And talking about lenses is quite appropriate because, you know, we are in the land of Spinoza, which, as you know, his profession was to produce lenses. And it's interesting because Spinoza was born in Portugal and lived his life here, as you know. So I think that we should start with that idea. Well, basically, my problem is the following. So we start the 20th century, at the beginning of the 20th century, there was a huge social question in Europe. Europe was a turmoil, was a continent of lots of conflicts. There was prostitution, there was delinquency, there was problems of sanitation, expelled peasants from the cities and the cities with no capacity to house them. There was problems of diseases, and we came to call that social question. That was the social question. And at the time, we didn't have much knowledge to deal with these issues. You have to understand that at the time, you know, the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, we were starting with social sciences. And in fact, the social sciences start in Europe to solve the social question, in a sense, to address the social question. And in fact, that's the main impetus behind the development of the social sciences. But at that time, we are going to, the knowledge that we are going to develop is going to consolidate two major forms of social transformation. We are, at that time, of course, you know, the Industrial Revolution had been in 1830 and so on, so we were with the consequences of that revolution, but this was a kind of upward type of looking, a kind of a time of hope in the midst of fears. And again, here Spinoza is very to the point, because Spinoza also claimed that we have two basic emotions, fear and hope. And in fact, there should be an equilibrium between the two of them, because hope without fear creates voluntarism and sometimes disaster, and fear without hope, takes us into paralysis and decadence and probably resignation. So I think that at that time, I would say that hope probably prevailed over fear, in spite of all the problems of the social question. So there were two main models of social transformation, revolution and reformism. From the very beginning, the fields are divided, the camps are divided. On one side, we have the revolutionary forces, we have scientific knowledge behind them, which is Marxism, and then you have reformism, split within the working class movement that think that, in fact, through law, we can achieve all the same, basically the same objectives as the revolution at the time. That was the idea, that the future society would be a socialist society. But there were two ways of reaching that. One was through breaks and ruptures with the past, which was the Russian Revolution. And the other one was the gradual, incremental type of transformation, peaceful, institutional, through legal institutions, through political system that would bring about basically the same type of society and probably even a better society. And at that time, the way in which these camps are going to be divided is that sometimes it's the idea that revolution was good for Russia because Russia was the least developed country in Europe at the time, but for the most developed, more developed countries, we should have something better, and something better would be reformism. So there were these two models of social transformation. What happens today? We are at the beginning of the 21st century, and we are left with none, neither revolution nor reformism. We are very happy when the parties that are not reformists win elections, because in fact we are at a time in which fear prevails over hope, in a sense. So what happens to our societies that started with these two models, and at the beginning of the 21st century we have none? In fact, that is even the idea that the best thing that we, well, for a long time, since the 80s, Margaret Thatcher said that there is no alternative. So the idea that there is no alternative, so therefore, we have just to manage this society. So I'd like to engage with this issue, because these two models at the beginning of the 20th century were very interesting, because they were very different, of course. The parties were polarized in all this, but they have something in common. Basically, there is a faith in science. Now, scientific knowledge was very, very important. Secondly, the idea that social transformation will come about through a centralized state and through a uniform system of law. So one law, one state, one education system, and later on one health system and one welfare system. So these ideas were, of course, very divided in revolutionary camp and reformist camp. And for a long time, I'm not going to tell you the fate of these two models. What I'm saying is that at the beginning of the 21st century, it looks like we have none. And the most disturbing thing for us is that we have accumulated so much knowledge. I mean, the people at the beginning of the 20th century, they really lacked scientific knowledge about the society, because what we had at the time was natural sciences, what we call natural sciences. Society was not an object of study. We had a Fourier, we had others, Saint-Simon, the precursors. But you know, if you look at Kant, Durkheim, and Max Weber, and Marx and Karl Marx, all of them are producing their theories at the beginning of the century. And it is these theories that are going to found the social sciences. Well, 100 years later, the results are not brilliant. We have so much knowledge about our societies, but apparently this knowledge is useless. Our knowledge that we developed at universities is not preventing our societies from living under massive forms of false consciousness. The process by which victims turn against victims and oppressed elect to government the oppressor. Look at South Africa. South Africans, poor South Africans, turning against the immigrants from Nigeria, from Mozambique, from Zimbabwe. Well, these immigrants, they have their wealth is 0.001 of the wealth of South Africa. And they are victims of xenophobia. Well, the white population is 8.7% of the population, and they have 86% of the wealth of South Africa. But there is no xenophobia against the whites. It's just against the blacks. Why is that? Victim turning against victim. And we see, as probably, and the dean mentioned, I live for the past 30 years. I live 5 months per year between August and December in the United States. And I can see how, in the recent elections, the poor white workers were turning against the poor Latino workers. Victim against victim. And in a sense, this false consciousness allows us that the people that are oppressed, sometimes they elect to power the people that oppress them. There was a time, for the older people here will know, that after the war, being rich was, people were almost ashamed of being rich. And they would pay very heavy taxes. Nobody probably remembers here, but many people probably will have studied that the richest people in our continent would pay sometimes 70% of their wealth in taxes after the war to build the welfare state that we were striving at. Well, today we live in a world that, according to the Oxfam, the 8 richest men have as much wealth as the poorest half of the world population. So as much wealth as 3.5 billion people in the world. This is preposterous, or not? Is this normal, or is a banalization of horror? That we are so trivialized. I always remember that when I was at the London School of Economics in the 80s, I would go home through the Strand, I would see two or three people sleeping on the street, homeless people, and I would arrive at home and I couldn't sleep. How is it possible? I was coming from Portugal, a less developed country in Europe, but Britain was so developed. How is it possible that people have no house to sleep at night? And sometimes it's cold. And sometimes I had to take a pill in order to be able to sleep, because I was so anxious about the fate of these people. Well, today, between my house and my office in Madison, per day, I see 30, 40 people living on the street, sleeping on the street. And sometimes it's -2, -5 degrees Celsius, and they are there. And I don't take pills anymore. So the horror has been trivialized, in a sense. I got accustomed to that. and probably many other people like me have done the same. So I think that since the results are not brilliant, I think we have to raise a question that questions our knowledge. Should we entertain other types of knowledge that allows us to produce radical diagnoses of our societies and become more aware of the social experience of the world? That is an experience of suffering, but also an experience of creativity, of innovation, that sometimes we're not aware of. So my project, the Alice project, was about that, and we did our studies in some countries outside Europe, and it was Ecuador, Bolivia, Brazil, South Africa, India, and Mozambique. And then we compared the results, in fact, with issues in Portugal, in Spain, in the UK, and France, and in Italy. For instance, we compare parties, the new parties in India, the AM party, for instance, with the Cinque Stelle in Italy. So to try to see how we could see realities arising from different continents. Could we learn from each other? Could we see the dangers or the possibilities from each other? So a different kind of dialogue. But for that, probably, we need a different kind of knowledge. That's my idea. So before I engage that very briefly, I would like to tell you very briefly, and then we could then discuss in the debate. I see seven threats in our societies. Probably in our protected societies of Europe, we don't see them very clearly, but we see them emerging. And there are things that were absolutely out of the picture and are now becoming more and more prevalent. So I see seven threats and five monsters. So I'm going to talk very briefly about the threats and the monsters beforehand I'll tell you what is a monster for me. Well, the first threat is disfiguring of the state. The state is being reconfigured and disfigured because the state, as part of the modern regulation, the modern regulation is based on three pillars: the pillar of the state, the pillar of the market, and the pillar of the community. And the idea in the liberal theory of the state, it is necessary to build a kind of an equilibrium between the three pillars. Of course, there has been a time in which the pillar of the state prevailed over the community and over the market. We are at a time in which the principle of the market prevails over the state and over the community. And in a sense, the state has to behave like a market. So the state that was responsible for non-mercantile relationships among citizens now is privatizing, is turning non-mercantile relationships into mercantile relationships everywhere in the world, sometimes more, sometimes less. But we are resisting in Europe, but the resistance is probably losing steam in some countries. The second one is the hollowing out of democracy. Democracy, even the liberal democracy, has a kind of a built-in tension with capitalism, because capitalism is about infinite accumulation. And democracy, even liberal democracy, because of the rights, because of the social inclusion, needs a measure of social redistribution. So the tension is there. And the highest tension was what we call social democracy. That was the form that consolidated the highest tension, but the regulated tension, by the way, for 30 years was regulated. Now it's being unregulated, and we see the crisis everywhere of this system. I come from a country that has been under supervision of the IMF, Portugal, and the World Bank and Central Bank of Europe. So, and in a sense, also disfiguring this type of democracy that we have. So what we do is the following, is that sometimes, and I'd like to discuss this with Michael here, that it's fine that we have philanthropy in our society, it's absolutely fine, but we're used to the idea that we're social and economic rights, that people have social and economic rights, so that they don't depend on the veto power of people. So that is why I give today something to you, but tomorrow if I decide not to give any donation, I don't. I have no obligation to do so, right? So I think that today we live in societies, and my work outside of Europe is very telling on this. And my fear is that probably these realities that we see outside Europe may come to Europe sooner or later. It's the idea that lots of populations live at the mercy of the philanthropy of others. And therefore, they don't have rights, in fact. They have formal rights, but they don't have rights in actual terms. So they depend on the philanthropy. And these philanthropic organizations have a veto powers over their lives. And sometimes if we erode the social laws, then the social laws put the weaker part at the mercy of the stronger party. I mean, my colleague knows about, well, about the labor law. Of course, labor law was precisely invented to protect the weaker party in the labor contract. Otherwise, the weaker party, because would I ever to accept the conditions of the stronger party? Because if I'm a worker and I'm unemployed and I have my family at home and they are hungry, I'm not going to discuss about the minimum wage. I mean, I have to accept the wage they give me, unless there is collective bargaining, unless there are social labor. So I think there is an empty gout of democracy with the erosion of social economic rights. The third threat is destruction of nature. I think that is probably consensual to all of us that, in fact, capitalism is reaching the limit of the overload of nature so that the regeneration cycles are being endangered. You know, global warming and so on, you know, are signs of this. And we, this is a very tricky threat because it's urgent. Look at the United Nations. They say, you know, in 20 years or 10 years, the global warming will be reversible. So it's very urgent. The problem is that in order to achieve what is necessary to reverse this, we need a change in civilization. We don't change a civilization in 4 years. Our habits, our cars, our clothes, our houses, our way of eating, of going around. So I think that we have a problem here between urgency and civilization change. The fourth one is the threat is devaluation of labor. Labor is being developed, and in a sense, it's very interesting to see what's happening, not just outside Europe, but in the United States and here, is that the distinction between paid and unpaid labor is being eroded. We knew that was, of course, a massive unpaid labor in our society, which is the domestic labor done by women, basically at home, the second shift, sometimes third shift. But now there is lots of unpaid labor. In the United States, in sociology of labor, we have developed a category of wage theft. It's the hours that are not paid, the extra hours that we need to get to work, the preparation to get to work that are not paid. All the young people today spend hours and hours on the computer writing CVs, preparing the interviews and so on for a job that may come or not come. All these preparations for the job are not paid. They have to go home with labor, with work. We are some multinational corporations today want their workers available 24 hours a day. That's part of the contract. And they can't go to certain bars, as you know, and to frequent certain bars or neighborhoods in our societies. So this is something that is, in my view, attacking labor. The fifth one has a lot to do with us, is commodification of knowledge. I see that every day, particularly in Madison, Wisconsin. The only knowledge that has value is the value, is the knowledge with a market value. That's why you see the buildings in biology and nanotechnology is going up every day in my university in Madison. But social science are closing, the humanities are closing, the departments have not no funds to go on because humanities, history, what is the market value of history, of the humanities, of literature, of comparative literature? So in some countries, we can see that all this knowledge that has no market value, and it should have no market value, by the way, has no value at all for our universities. And this is a challenge for the universities. The sixth one is the recolonization of difference. I think that colonialism was not over with independence of the countries that were colonies of Europe. And I come from a country that really colonized more countries over more continents over a longer period of time since the 15th century. We thought that when they became independent, colonialism was over, but it was not over. Not just because there is neocolonialism, but because there is racism, that is xenophobia, that is the unsolved colonial questions of Europe, which now we call the so-called refugee crisis. It's not something engendered by the mafias, it's the unsolved settling of accounts of European colonialism. So I think that colonialism is not over, it has changed. And we should face the fact that was probably a huge mistake by the Marxism that only looked at capitalism, didn't look at colonialism in social relations, the discrimination in functions of the color of the skin, didn't look on the discrimination on the basis of sex, patriarchy. So I see these three dominations very strong today, colonialism, capitalism, and patriarchy. And they work together. They work together. I have always a story, a very simple story. You can see it in the news. You know that President Dilma was a woman, the president of Brazil, and she was impeached. The most honest politician in Latin America was ousted by the most corrupt politicians in Latin America, legally, constitutionally. So that's the problem of our law and our democracies. Well, this woman, they committed lots of mistakes, this president. I was a friend of her, but always very critical of lots of things that they did wrongly. But they had women there, and they had black people as ministers and secretary of states. When they changed government, they were just men, white, no woman, no black guy. That is to say, once you really try to strengthen the capitalist nature of Brazil, we have to strengthen also the colonial aspect of it, so no black guy should be minister, and also the sexist way, so no woman should be minister. And even the president said, well, in fact, we didn't find a woman that would be adequate for the job, which is remarkable, right? So the final threat is the criminalization of social protest. I'm very concerned with that because we work in these countries that I mentioned to you. We see today that social protest is being criminalized everywhere with anti-terrorist laws. And I think that probably the most damaging in my work is that these laws are being applied against indigenous people. Indigenous people were never terrorists. But the anti-terrorist laws now are drawn in such a way that if an indigenous people blocks a road in order to prevent a multinational corporation to enter their territories, this is a terrorist act. And they are labeled terrorists. And it's very serious because the criminal sanctions and also the rights of defense are very diminished in that case. So we are applying anti-terrorist laws to people that are not terrorists. They are defending their territories. So I think the criminalization of protests is very serious. So I don't think I have time to go through all the monsters. You know, the monster in sociology, in political sociology, comes from Antonio Gramsci, a very well-known Marxist of the early 20th century in Italy, because Gramsci said, well, we are at a time in which the new is not yet born, and the old resists to end. So we are a time in between, in transition. And he said, this is a time of monsters, of malformations, of things that are simultaneously familiar and threatening by their size, by their form, and by the way they present to us. Well, just a couple of words on some of these monsters. The first one is the dronification of power. What do I mean by that? You know, military drones. Military drones is the most common form of irregular war today. It violates all the conventions because, in fact, is such unequal, the power relation between the persons or the state that owns the drones and the ones that suffer the consequences, that this inequality is so huge, so extreme, because someone that is killing in Afghanistan or Yemen is killing from Nebraska, is killing in front of a screen of a computer. And there are no heroes in this because the heroes are computer programs. there is no danger of being killed by the enemy because it's so far away. This extreme form of power under democracy is what I call dronification of power, because the drones are a metaphor of extreme power. Another form of extreme power is financial capital. Financial capital today in many countries is a drone. Look at the Greeks. The Portuguese also could be, or the Spaniards, and tomorrow the Italians. From one way to the next, our debt increases 10, 20%. Because some people are playing in the computers, speculating against the foreign debt of these countries. And all of a sudden, the so-called sovereign debt of Greece goes up 10% from one day to the next. Nothing happened in the real economy, but we are poorer the next day. And the people that did this are much richer the next day. Speculation. Financial capital is an anti-social form of capitalism. And this is the form that is prevailing today. And the problem in our society is this is not a problem for the poor countries in the world. It's coming closer and closer. Remember, all these structural adjustment austerity measures were applied in Mexico, in Thailand, in Indonesia. And now they are being applied in Greece, in Portugal, in Spain, tomorrow in Italy, and who knows next? We never know. So I think that this dronification of power is one of the monsters, because it's a power that is so extreme but is democratic. We are not talking about dictatorships. It's not military dictatorship or any other. The second one is that the institutions are used to operate extra-institutionally. Look at that. It's interesting. If you pay attention to what's going on in politics, is that sometimes our institutions are there, are in place, but they are not working according to the rules of those sanctions, of those institutions. There is a kind of an informal exercise of power by the formal authorities. I give you two examples from different countries so that you don't see that just one country. Well, Trump, at this point, Trump is an informal power. Trump legislates by Twitter. Can we imagine a more informal way of exercising power, democratic power? We have seen investments by the Ford Foundation, by the Ford company, that are canceled because they received a Twitter. Oh, no, I know that as business people, they are much smarter, probably, than this tweeting thing. They know that they were going to gain something from not investing in Mexico. But in any case, deciding policies by Twitter. See how close the power is to you. It's a tweeting, so it gets home. It's informal, but it's so powerful because it's the president of the United States. But another example, so that you don't think that I have anything against Trump. I may have, but not just specially against him. I mean, he's a symptom. He's not a cause of anything. He's a symptom of something else. It's Duterte, Rodrigo Duterte, in the Philippines. You have probably read in the press that the guy wants to get rid of the criminals, of the people that drug dealers and so on. So we kill them. Why should we go to courts? Why should would we put them in prison? We just killed them. And when he was mayor of a city, he did that directly. He says that. Informal power by a president of a republic elected democratically. There's something wrong here. Because there is no United Nations to say, this is not possible. We can't do this way. And we always think that it's in the Philippines. I mean, it's not here. Well, we never know. The third monster is the sacrificial violence in our society, that we sacrifice the most cherished values that we have under the pretext of defending them. We destroy Libya to bring about democracy. We really violate human rights in Iraq and Syria in order to protect human rights. We destroy Afghanistan to protect human rights. It's a great philosopher from Germany, Franz Inkelhammert, talks about sacrificial violence, because he used these concepts to destroy things that should be protected by these values. But we do that in name of those values. So this is a monster. And the final monster is the concept of crisis. All of you know that in Greece, the Greek root of the word crisis is like to be sick. It's in Greek. To be sick is to be in crisis. And of course, it's an opportunity for you to get healthy, get cured. It's an opportunity for a new. So whenever we have a crisis, we have to explain the crisis in order to restore the system to the normal, be it our body, be it our society. What happens when the crisis becomes permanent? We live in society from the last 10 years in Europe in which the crisis is permanent. What happens? See, as this twist, because the interesting twists in social science is the ones that are not visible at all, but you have to pay attention to them, is when the crisis becomes permanent, the crisis does not have to be explained. It explains everything. In sociology, we say that crisis ceases to be a dependent variable and becomes an independent variable. So if we cut the salaries, my pension was cut, the salaries are cut because of the crisis. We have to privatize health because of the crisis. We have to privatize the system of pensions because of the crisis. So the crisis explains everything instead of being explained by us. So the only thing that is not in crisis in our society is the crisis. All the rest seems to be in crisis. And this is leading, in fact, to the politics of resentment, that really people turn against each other, victims against victims, oppressed against oppressed. So this diagnosis has led me to the idea that probably we need an epistemological intervention. That is to say, we need a different kind of knowledge, because law, in fact, has been part of all these radical. We have abundant laws, we have constitutions, we have everything. And I have been, as the dean said, all my work has been on trying to solve this question. Can law be emancipatory? Because I've been working with the landless movement in Brazil and the indigenous people in Ecuador, and they use the courts and they use the constitution in order to promote their rights. So it is possible. It is possible, but under which conditions? And that's the problem today, because I see that today, to answer positively to this question is much harder than it was 10 years ago. 10 years ago was much easier for me to say, yes, law can be emancipatory. Today, I have much more doubts. Not doubts, it's more demanding, the situation. Why is it so? Because in the meantime, I decided to, in order to understand what's going on in Europe and in the world, I moved my work and my field work outside Europe to see what's going on in there. And for a long time, and going back to history and seeing what are the root causes of this. And I came to the conclusion that from the very early modernity, we have a division in our social theory that is quite invisible for the people that are here in Europe in general. The division is what I call a very radical division between metropolitan social relations and colonial social relations. It starts very early on, 15th century, I would say, or 16th century probably, but already in the 15th. So the idea is that what applies, what is valid in the metropolitan social relations is not valid in the colonial relations. The colonial relation is something else. And we decided, in fact, we drew, our social theories drew what I call an abyssal line between these two realities so that they become incommensurable. What is applicable in the metropolitan societies and social relations is not applicable in the colonial social relations. And these two realities become incommensurable. Since the 16th century up until now, the abyssal line. And what is the difference? Is that in the metropolitan side of social relations, there may be exclusion, but we have rights. We can claim rights. We are human, and we are citizens. and we can claim rights. So the exclusion is not abyssal. But in the field of colonial relations, the exclusion is abyssal. People have no rights because sometimes they are not even fully human. I'm going to explain that in detail because I think it's important for you to understand this abyssal line that I'm saying didn't end with the end of colonialism, is in our societies, is in our streets, is in our cities. This abyssal line separating a civilized metropolitan way of doing social relations and the violent way, colonial way of doing social relations. And we are divided in this. I give you three examples. First example. We are celebrating, and no one will know much more than this, that we are celebrating at the end of the 19th century the birth of labor law. Labor law was the protective law by excellence. And in fact, was not developed by leftists, was developed by rightists in the origins. But of course, under the pressure of the labor movement, and the idea was to protect the weaker part, the worker, of course, vis-a-vis the employer. So labor law as protection, it's very important for us in Europe and in the metropolitan forms of sociability. At that very same time, something that never comes into our labor law books, at the very same time, labor law on the colonies in the colonial social relations was penal law, was slave labor still, was forced labor. Shibalo, as the British called it. So two pictures of labor law that are contemporaneous. But when we look at labor law as protective, we don't see labor law as penal law. Because these two realities don't belong to each other. Because one thing is the colonial world, other thing is the metropolitan world. The second example, citizenship. We have always learned that citizenship is about inclusion. Because what is a citizen? Is an upgraded form of being a human. Because it has rights, and of course duties also, but rights. So citizenship is about inclusion. But stop for a moment. The vast majority of the people in the world are non-citizens. They don't belong to any citizenship with rights. Where does it come from? The theories of citizenship that we really have can be understood as much as theories of inclusion as theories of exclusion. I'm going to give you some examples. First of all, citizenship rights don't apply to non-humans. This is a specific Western conception. Because in other cultures, non-humans have rights. For instance, if you go to Africa to the peasants or to indigenous people, the ancestors have rights. Yesterday I was telling some stories of my field research to the students. The ancestors are with us here. They have rights. But in our ontology, whoever is dead has no rights. So non-humans have no rights. But we don't give rights to the future generations because they are not yet born. But if you look at other cultures, the future generations have rights. So our theory of citizenship is very selective when we compare with other cultures. Secondly, the theory of citizenship does not apply to subhumans. Historically, there were two types of subhumans, women and the colonized populations. What is a subhuman? Is an entity that by her or characteristics is bound to have more duties than rights. The symmetry between rights and duties does not apply to them because they are subhuman. It was a long story before the subhumans could become full human and citizens and claim citizenship rights. Then there is a third category. That's what is most worrying to me in Europe and elsewhere, are the exclusion of what we call the discardable populations. They are discarded from citizenship, not because of what they are, but because what they do. They are discardable. They should have no rights. Sometimes they are interned in camps. Sometimes they die in the liquid cemetery that the Mediterranean is today. And if the people don't reach the liquid cemetery, which is the Mediterranean, they die before in the dry cemetery of the Sahara. So there are people in our societies that are becoming discardable. In fact, workers without rights is a form of discardable population. Precariat. This is not happening elsewhere. I think the idea of rights, of work without rights, is a form of creating discardable populations. And we should be aware of this, because after all, you can see how our categories of revolution and reformists don't apply to us anymore. Because, you know, to have work with rights, you know, a job with some stability, with some rights, well, this is revolutionary for the young people. I mean, it was for my generation and for the generation of the people here, was a kind of a reformist. We wanted socialism. We wanted something else. That would be the revolution. Public health, public education were reforms, were, you know, social democratic aims. Well, these are revolutionary today in many ways. Even here in Europe, talk to the Greeks at this point. If you go to Greece, and my colleague goes there, and you can see how people are really, with a country that lost 25% of GDP in 4 years, how they are living, surviving. And Portugal lost 6% of GDP, so it was not as serious. And now we are recovering, but it takes a long time. So I think that our theories leave out lots of people. That's why, by far, the majority of the population is not a subject of human rights in real terms, is an object of our discourses of human rights. Most people in the world, in fact, today, they have no rights, actually. But they are bombarded by our discourses of human rights, sometimes NGOs, sometimes, etc. So given this, there is this resilience of people that stay on the other side of the line, abyssally excluded, that is to say, exclusion without rights. And you say, well, but this happens in peripheral societies, not in our societies. No, it happens in our societies. You know how I see it? If try to imagine, we have to be a bit imaginative in our social sciences today. See the abyssal line as an abyssal line, and see that people, there are people in our societies that cross the abyssal line every day. A woman is working in a job, on a job. And in that job, she has rights. Probably she is excluded because for the same type of work, she doesn't get the same salary. So there is a non-abyssal exclusion, exclusion with rights. This woman, when arrives at home and is assassinated by the husband or the companion, or is violated, or is victim of a gang rape, as it happens in India so often, this woman crossed the abyssal line. At that point, she's not fully human. She has no rights anymore. So she has rights while she's in the job, but then she loses all the rights. She's not really human. So this happens every day. A Muslim worker that works in a restaurant, he may be discriminated against because his salary should be a bit higher than the people from the country that is hosting. But he has rights. He's a worker. And he has rights. But this guy leaves the office and on the street may be object of suspicion, as a suspect of terrorism, maybe victim of police brutality. If he's black in the United States, he's a young black guy, definitely is going to be victim of brutality. And it's not just in the United States, it's in Brazil. In the city of Ceará and in the city of Salvador da Bahia, where the majority of the population is black, 4 young kids, young black Brazilians, are assassinated by the police. Do they have rights? No. Because of their skin, they are subhumans. So these people have rights when they are in school or in their work, but they cross the abyssal line. And when they cross the abyssal line, the rights are not there. So I think that in our analysis of law, in our law schools, for instance, we should pay attention to this situation, because the theories that we have developed, I myself have written several books about this, I have always focused on the metropolitan forms of sociability, because I didn't care what I was not so much aware of law operating in the colonial type of relations. Because probably the colonial type of relations was happening elsewhere, but now it's happening in our societies. So the abyssal line is moving from the colonial, geographic colonial, to our own society. So it's something that has to be faced by us. So in that case, I think that we have to change probably our curricula. We have to change our way of understanding, even our history. Because if we look at this, then what we see, if we do the research, for instance, like the one and some colleagues here have been doing, is that people are not victims. That's the first thing that you should see. People resist. Resist humiliation, resist discrimination, resist exclusion. They are innovative. They find solutions. They are not cynic because they have to survive. They are alive today. They don't know if they will be alive tomorrow. They have to survive. And they are innovative, and they are creative, and they have cooperatives, and they have peasant economies, indigenous economies, women economies, arts and crafts by women everywhere, where we have several of them in our project. But this is not considered very relevant, because this type of economy is not capitalist economy. It's not the economy for which we train our people in the business schools. Because this is an economy based on solidarity, on reciprocity. Not in infinite, based on infinite accumulation. But the people there in the struggles, they develop their own laws. So there is a bottom-up law that is emerging there. It's not just mafias. There are people, sometimes if they don't have access to our lawyers because they are very expensive, what do? Are they just bandits? No. There are other forms of social ordering. You have, you can read, well, it was written many years ago when I did my dissertation at Yale. I lived for 4 months in a favela. And basically, my work is about the law and order inside the favela, the squatter settlement. Because the people were illegal. They had no access to the courts, to the official law. But they developed their own law. And I call that Pazarga the law. Pazarga is a name by a fictitious name because we were under dictatorship in Brazil and I could not name the community in which I was working in Rio de Janeiro. But they were not bandits. Well, there were bandits there as they are everywhere. But they have their own law. So legal plurality became very central in my work, legal pluralism. And the idea that we have to understand the law that comes from the struggles, the legal innovations that are developed by these people that should be better known, even when they are in international law, even in interest today, the African Union is developing lots of interesting ideas, but they never reach us because we tend to see these problems for our European eyes, so they are irrelevant. So I think that if we look at that, then we can imagine what I call, in this 5 minutes more, post-abyssal law, that is to say, a law that denounces the abyssal line, as I'm doing here, in order to supersede it. If you don't denounce the abyssal line, we cannot supersede it. We cannot solve it. I remember very some time ago when I was pleading for affirmative action in Brazil, you know, against the discrimination against black populations in Brazil, all my leftist friends would say, Boaventura, you are producing racism in Brazil because we are a democracy. We are a racial democracy. But you claiming that we are racist, this is dangerous because we may be racist, in fact, or become racist. And my answer was, well, if there is no racism, why 75% of the poor are blacks? And the darker the skin of their skin, the poorer they are. So that was racism, and today we have affirmative action. So we have to denounce racism in order to address it, to solve it. We have to address, to denounce the abyssal line in order to solve it. And if we do that, then we have to move to an idea of law that I cannot develop very extensively, but I can give you The idea is the following. We have to, in any period of society, we have to struggle, fight with the instruments that are at our disposal. Nobody invents struggles. Nobody invents great things when they are not available. And in fact, we are at a time in which we are going through the ruins of through models of social transformation, social revolution, and social reformism. So we cannot waste these ruins. We have to transform these ruins into seeds. So the key concept in my work, and a book of mine is coming out by Duke University Press, you can see the concept of ruin seed. A ruin is also a seed. We have to see the emergencies that coming from these ruins. I think that democracy today is becoming a ruin. As revolution was a ruin and is a ruin now. And if we go further and further, impoverishing our democracy will be soon a ruin. But we don't have anything else. And we don't have anything else but law. So in this respect, my way of formulating that in a very brief way is that we need to revolutionize democracy and to democratize revolution. Basically that. And law is crucial for both instances. How you revolutionize democracy? Because democracy is being shrinking. We deliberate more and more about less and less. Because the most important things in our world are outside our deliberative powers. They are decided by Goldman Sachs. They are not decided by us. So we have to expand deliberation. And if we do that, then we can try to attend to the following ideas, which I think would be very good topics for dissertations and for analysis in our law schools and social science schools. For instance, the law of the common goods. We should start thinking about things that cannot be sold or bought, common goods, from the outer space to water, for instance. We should claim that there are things that are common heritage of humankind, but they are not heritage, they are the future of humankind, and therefore they should not be object of appropriation. We should develop the law of the plurality of forms of democracy. That would be a new constitutional law. And again, I'm not inventing. I'm reading one article of the Constitution of Bolivia, which says that there are three kinds of democracy, and they should be equally respected by the citizens: representative democracy, participatory democracy, and communitarian democracy, democracy by consensus, which is typical of indigenous peoples. There was a time in which we had all these kinds of democracy, even in Europe. But since the 80s, we think that the only form of democracy is liberal democracy, is to put a vote every 4 years. What about participatory democracy? Instead of electing the decision makers, we ourselves decide in our councils. We have idea that worked, some of you know, on participatory budgeting in Brazil and in Latin America. Now it's being copied in Europe, participatory budgeting. In fact, there are some municipalities here in Holland that have participatory budgeting. So the citizens deciding where the investments of the municipality is going to be. So we are not against in any way. Oh, that's a ruin. Democracy, representative democracy, will be a ruin if it is not supported by participatory democracy. So I think we have to put them together. And this takes, of course, some work also. The third idea that I'd like to leave with you is the law for a state that is not uniform, a plurinational state, an intercultural state. I think we need more. Europe is becoming intercultural. And there are two reactions. One is deny that and go against that. We see that everywhere. The other one is to affirm this interculturality. And sometimes plurinationality. A great constitutionalist from Canada, a great friend of mine, James Tully, says in his work that why constitutionalism became the empire of uniformity. There should be more diverse forms of state organization. Why everything has to be the same way in the different regions? You are in a small country, I come from even a smaller country, but it's very diverse internally. So why don't we think about these forms? The fourth one, we need a new law of dignity. We are stuck with the idea of human rights. But I think human rights is just one language of dignity, and there are other languages of dignity, and we should pay attention to them. Of course, Ummah is one of languages of dignity in the Quran, and dignity, in fact, appears very often in the Quran. But the dignity of nature. And again, I'm not inventing. Article 71 of the Constitution of Ecuador, the rights of the Pachamama, the Mother Earth, the idea that nature have rights. We cannot imagine nature having rights because in our culture we are not Spinozians, we are Cartesians. Nature for us is a natural resource. It's not a sacred space. Rivers are not sacred for us. Forests are not safe, are not sacred. We are not part of that nature. It's against us. We are all children of the Frankfurt School, which made that distinction very clearly. Adorno and Horkheimer and so on. Why should nature not have rights? Probably the ecologists would be very happy in the future if nature would have rights. And in fact, it's in the Constitution. When I was there as an advisor, consultant for the Constitution, a member of the opposition came to me and said, Professor Boaventura, you come from Europe. I know that you know a lot of constitutional law and so on. Tell me something. These Indians are crazy, aren't they? They are trying to give rights to nature, but nature is an object. How can nature have rights? And I told him, yes, you are right for your training and my training. The Indians are of course, crazy, because for our conception of nature, they are crazy. The problem is that their conception of nature is not our conception. It's the Mother Earth, is a living entity to which we belong. Does not belong to us, we belong to it. It's completely different. So it's a different conception. So different stories of dignity. Why shouldn't we be studying them in our law schools and social sciences? Why shouldn't we do this? Because does not belong? No, because the world is another fit probably of globalization. Probably the world is becoming more global. Now we seem to be entering a period of deglobalization, quite frankly. But the globalization went so far ahead and the technologies of information that now these innovations are important not because they are good for the indigenous people, they are important for us. The concept of nature as Pachamama is good for us, is not good for them. That is for some reason that 75% of the biodiversity of the world is in indigenous territories, not in our territories. So I think that if we look at this closely, we have a broader picture of law, a broader picture of knowledge, knowledge that develops from struggle, bottom up, from the people's knowledge, and we have to do what I call ecology of legal knowledges. An ecology of knowledges is bringing together scientific knowledge with non-academic knowledge. I spend 50% of my time in university environments and 50% of my time in organization social movements. Why do I do that? Because in fact, in those areas, I see how other knowledges that are not academic knowledges feed so much into my theory, will help me as I help them. So we need not to be against scientific knowledge. Scientific knowledge is precious, but is one kind of knowledge. It's incomplete, and we should be open to other kinds. If we do that, then we will be able, in fact, to develop some forms of alternatives out of these ruined seeds, to develop some alternatives. Quite frankly, I have to say that, and I speak against myself because I've been teaching in a university in several universities for more than 40 years, is that sometimes we have spent too much time in training conformists and very often incompetent conformists. I think it is time for us to train competent rebels. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Santos. I'd like to now open the discussion with the panel, and if possible, I'd like to save some, say, 10, 15 minutes for questions from the public at the very end. And I will end by giving Ralf Embrex the word at the very end. He's going to tell us something about the project of quiet that he's been working with, and I think it's interesting for all of us to hear about. Who would like to kick off the discussion? There's no pre-given order here. Would someone of the panel like to begin with a question?
I will give it a try.
Sure.
Thanks for answering a few questions, but raise a lot of others. Because when I try to imagine from out of the position of the province how to start with this social new act, it's quite a job, you could say, because I think there is a problem with scales of our people has to, there are elections, and they have to try to find solutions on a scale which is not the scale of their normal life. And I wonder, are there solutions of how we can make the problems of a large scale, global, or on a nation size, useful for how they, the ordinary people, you could say, are managing that kind of problems? Okay, that's my most prominent question.
Would you want to take the microphone? Yes, please. Yes, of course it's.
Not someone else.
No, it's a good question, you know. But you know, this, we have to be transcalar. That is to say, we have to have a big picture to work, you know, at a very small scale. I think that in order to, for you to be effective in your struggle, we have to know the context in which you are. I mean, if you really look at your work as being isolated from the broader context, probably you don't understand why, for instance, Europe is becoming more intercultural, why we have a so-called crisis of refugees, why this coming. Everything is surprising because we don't know the context of it. But while we act, I mean, we have to pick up the struggles that are at our disposal. We don't invent struggles. I learned that with some people that work with Salvador Allende in Latin America. We never choose the struggle. The struggle chooses you. So you are in your village, in your city, and all of a sudden there is a task that has to be, you know, accomplished, and we start doing that. And it could be human rights, could be human trafficking, could be anything else. We don't choose our struggles. If you are waiting for the best struggle to struggle, you are going to be a cynical, you do nothing. So please use your small scale. What I would say is that there is a problem. You mentioned that something that is very important there. Is that if we are in society saturated with election logic, we know that, for instance, times of elections are times against social movements and social organizations, always, everywhere. That is a sociological law, right? So what we have to do is in the spaces between elections, well, instead of going home, trying to work with the organizations during the period in which people they are not so focused on the elections and try to do political education and work through that level. These things you can do, but elections are precious if, in fact, we have a free and system. And I think that in Europe, I have to say that we still have, but, you know, it's a minority of countries. And as I say, how I can say, you know, living in the United States, Hillary Clinton got 3 more million votes than Donald Trump, but Donald Trump is president. Can you imagine that in Europe? It wouldn't be possible, but it is possible there because of the great electors. So I think that we have to be very contextualized and you know, don't try to do the revolution, you know, around the world. Solve your problem. And by doing that, you are being a competent rebel.
Okay.
Come on. I'd like to ask the next question. Connie, and then,
I think it's okay. Yeah, it's okay. Yeah. Well, thank you very much for your very rich presentation. And indeed, it does raise a lot of questions and issues. And if I were not an optimist, I would be in a depression now, I think, if the state of the art of the world today. But I do share your observation in the increasing divide between the deserving and the non-deserving, and those who profit and those who do not profit. And I was actually taken by your comment on the change from paid labor to unpaid labor. And we've just finished a research on access to the labor market for refugees here in the Netherlands. And there also you see a lot of unpaid labor, voluntary labor, which were in jobs that were paid jobs before. So there is actually a combination of problems there, so accumulation of problems, if you may. And there's, of course, well, from my perspective, if we look at exploitation of people, there's a high risk if it is a stepping stone to a paid job, then it's okay. But if they stay in that unpaid job, which is often the case for longer than strictly necessary, then that's a serious problem. I was a bit concerned about your analysis of the role of the law in general, and I was happy to hear that you'll have also some positive remarks and some positive role for the law, and also in on human rights law, because I think in some instances it can be a corrective mechanism, but it is a complicated one, I think. So on the one hand, law does categorize people, so does exclude people and does include people. But I'm always very optimistic about the role of human rights and the universality of human rights and the fundamental rights. Although I see also in my research that people cannot access those rights, there is, I consider it a safety net. And then there's the leading up to the question, actually, where you started your presentation with, is that we as Europeans should go back to school, not as the professors, but as the students. And I would love to go to such a school, and I hope you're the teacher. So last week, our institute's interfic was visited by Stephen Ulla. And he has been involved in the peace talks in Juba with the Uganda and the Lord's Resistance Army. And he was actually giving examples about the local justice systems in Uganda. And he was quite positive about it. So, and it's very the communal values and the communities that plays a role there. So there was one example that he gave that was the matuput, so drinking the bitter, and they do it as a community, as a kind of clearance, and also so leave the past behind. And I was actually wondering how we can learn from these practices. We also know them from the Kachacha courts in Rwanda, and especially in situations of transitional justice. So make it maybe a bit more concrete. So if somewhere in the future the war in Syria ends, so what would be the solution, or the solution, so where do we start? Taking into account the local, also the local systems of justice, and what is the role of the international community and international law? Well, a lot of questions again.
So, Lord, thank you so much, Connie. No, it's, well, absolutely important issues. Well, I think, well, the paid and paid labor is good, so I don't go into that. But I think that, you know, I'm very, probably I'm today, these days, I've been very hurt, I would say, by the work that we did with the movement of landless in Brazil. It's considered one of the most vibrant social movements in the world because it's connected with Via Campesina, and the president of Via Campesina now is a good friend of mine, Elizabeth Mopo from Zimbabwe. And really, in fact, we gained some, for instance, legalization of land, the title to land through courts and so on. It was very positive, and was my key case in the emancipatory aspect of the law. All of a sudden, the political environment changes, and now the attorney, the state attorney of Rio Grande do Sul, is investigating the landless movement as a terrorist organization. So it should be, you know, illegalized, and the leader should be in prison. So the same legal system, on one side, promotes this, and at the same time considers them terrorists. So we have to analyze that, is this a unified system? Well, in our systems of theory of law, we cannot think otherwise. But in fact, we see a duality here. The same system using parallel evaluations of the different realities. So this probably is a kind of a sobering experience for me. But you know, I'm a tragic optimist. So there is to say, I'm really optimist about the weapons that we have, but I have to see the difficulties that we are facing. For instance, rule of law and democracy. If you read a very fabulous text by James Tully on law and democracy and imperialism, which is interesting, is that we cherish rule of law because it's our law, it's our rule of law, but to try to spend billions and billions of dollars to impose the rule of law in Russia after the fall of the Soviet Empire, then all the other countries in the Balkans and so on, and nothing works. I mean, billions of dollars, and what they say, there is a beautiful article in the Michigan Law Review last year about the disappointing results. That is to say, so much money and nothing happened. Why? Because it was imposed. I mean, law is to be, I'm against legal transplants because they were really part of colonialism. Now, take the civil code as the French civil code was taken to Ethiopia, and of course it worked in the city, but not outside. So I think that how can we develop organic forms of legal culture that are coincident with our substantive values? Because if they come from outside, they are impositions. If they are impositions, are violence. And that's why in transitional justice, and you are right, and I know some other cases, in which, in fact, it is all the transitional, particularly the very violent conflicts, all the successes usually rely on local, traditional ways of purification. Look at, for instance, South Africa. It failed in many respects because Nelson Mandela, he had to make a negotiations, a very tricky negotiations of getting political power but not economic power over land. And therefore, we have a time bomb in South Africa. But in fact, the reason why it was possible to create rainbow a nation at the time, up until recently, was not because of the laws of the constitutional court, was because of Ubuntu, which is a concept of Zululand that means basically that I am because you are. Therefore, I'm not alone, and you are not alone, I'm not alone. I am because you are because I am. So the idea that the purification has to be a collective type of exercise. And we have to pardon, but in a different sense. It's not a Catholic or Protestant way of pardoning, but the way that our humanness, our ontology, in fact, is partial if we don't count on the other. So this is good. But again, you cannot romanticize it. Now I'm going against my own argument. That is to say, sometimes the local law is also very, very despotic. I mean, you cannot have a romantic view of the other, because for some studies of legal pluralism in southern part of Italy is to consider the mafia laws, because the mafia laws are illegal. For those people that are subjected to them, they are much less democratic than the state law of Italy. So I think that we have to have a political evaluation of the different legalities and how much based they are in the local cultures. If we do that, then I think that we can move forward. But for me, in Europe and the European Union today, what I think we should do is to be very careful about not causing the problems that then we have to solve. The people living in Syria, they were living in Iraq, they were living in Somalia, they were living in Ethiopia. Why they became refugees? Something happened. It's not they that decided to travel. We destroyed their countries, basically. We, I'm saying, you know, the United States and Europe. Libya is a good case, a good example. Failed states. I happen to be a good friend of them because he was prime minister in Portugal, the new general secretary of the United Nations, a great diplomat, a great politician. I think that he may be very successful. I wish him all the successes. But we have been discussing in the past, what is a failed state? They are made to fail. they not necessarily would be failing. They are failed because structural adjustment, austerity measures, because of this imposition of financial capital. So I think that we have a lot, the more developed country has a lot of responsibility in not creating problems. If we don't create problems, it's already something. Then we have to solve some of these problems, but not in the ways that we have been solving them.
Thank you very much. Can you hear me? Yeah? Okay. Yes, thank you very much for your lecture. My question was about another issue, because you raised a lot of interesting issues. But for me personally, the most, what I learned most about was what you said about our conception of law and rights, and that it's being a really Western look. And I knew somewhere that, you know, there was this bias in there, but no, it's true, we never learned that actually in law school. And so my question was related to a ruling of the Court of Justice a few days ago, European Court of Justice, that said that a Muslim worker could be dismissed because she was wearing a veil. And the Court of Justice actually said that, well, they left a lot to lower courts to decide, and I hope they do that in a good way. But they said that in principle, it is a legitimate aim of a business to want to have neutral workers, or they wanted neutrality, so they prohibited all the workers. That's why it wasn't direct discrimination. They prohibited all the workers to wear any signs of religious, but also political or philosophical signs. And so I was thinking just now, like, but neutral, it does seem like, okay, so that's, it seems logical at first glance, but neutral in our Western societies, that means something different, doesn't it? It's actually something very specific. And for females, I think it's like, where, like I look today a bit, like wearing heels and a skirt, but that's not how all people, thankfully, today in society, choose to look like. So that's, yeah, I'm a bit concerned about that ruling. And I was, yeah, curious whether you would share that concern. And a more open question, would that be a more abyssal or non-abyssal exclusion?
Well, thank you very much. It's a very good question. Well, I'm against the ban in the way it was formulated by the court, because I think that we have to distinguish between secular and secularism. Secularism is really a very radical way of dividing the religious from the non-religious, while secular is something else. Is the possibility that you are secular and I'm not secular, and we live together, and we have to accommodate, in a sense. That's the key concept in that, in these areas. So I think that this is an expression of secularism, because we don't like to have these religious type of symbols in our uniforms. Nobody should have. But it's like Saint-Exupéry. I mean, the rich and the poor, both of them are prohibited from living under the bridges, of course. But, you know, it's not the same thing being rich and poor. I think there is here still a mixture of colonialism and patriarchy, because the case was based about women, and usually are the women that are there. Someone is trying to control the body. So racialized bodies and sexualized bodies are still a very ingrained form of prejudice in our societies. So I think the court lost an opportunity for interculturality. Basically, because it's not coherent, because we know that there are lots of other religious symbols that we don't consider religious because they are so familiar to us. Because if I go to my job and I use my cross as a Catholic, as I am a Catholic, nobody bothers me, because after all of us are Catholic or Protestant, whatever. So our ghosts are never ghosts if they are familiar. The problem is with the non-familiar ghost. And I think that the court lost an opportunity to do what we call intercultural jurisprudence, I think it would be a very fine way, in my view.
I have a question about the labor law you mentioned in the earlier of your. And when we just met, I told you that I work 500 meters from here in the poorest area of Tilburg, at the favelas of Tilburg. It's 500 meters from here, and an area of 7,000 people, and half of them are unemployed. And each house next to each other. And now, when the crisis is end, I don't. The jobs are not rolling in my areas for the people. They still stay unemployed. And we have labor laws to help people to get work and to stay in work, because one of the things to get out of poverty is to get work. You get more money, you get to in a community of work. And then in this country, The Hague, the government, the national government, makes laws. If you have 2 years a flex law contract, then they have to give you a full contract. That's right. But what is the law after 1 year and 9 months to young people, 23, 24 in my areas, they go out and not get the job? So that law, what was meant to protect people, are excluding people. And I have to explain the young guys in my area not to go in criminality, because the same area here is the wheat, I don't know the smoke there, capital of the world. So don't get your money in the hash and wheat criminality. So what's then the function of a labor law to protect people? I cannot explain it to my people, the young people or the old people. So the labor law is flexed.
Well, there was a lot about this on the flex laws. No, the law was made for that purpose, quite frankly. I mean, we know everywhere, because it's not just Holland. All the countries now have the same directive, and they apply basically the same rules. So we have 2 or 3 years of a precarious contract, so to say, or a term contract, and then at the end they should become permanent. But there is no clause that forces you to make it permanent. But this one on purpose. This was done by the parliaments with the lobbies of the employers that wanted that. So it's really a fiction. In this case, the law is a fiction to allow to transform what they call flexibility into precariousness, because that's what it is. It's precariat. And the precariat is a new name for sociology of labor now for young people. So I think that what the purpose of the law was that. Was
there are no rebels, Mayor, in my area. People are.
Oh, yeah, I know.
I don't see the in 100 years ago, they became the rebels. You told us. But now people are. Yesterday they go 1 day voting, a little bit rebel. That's all.
Trade unions, for instance, are not interested in them. Socialist parties are not interested in them.
Socialist parties.
Nobody's interested
parties.
In them, basically.
<They are. laughs>
That's a some problem
them,
in Holland.
Some of them win, but a lot of socialists lose.
And what about the basic income? What about that idea as the solution?
Yeah, that's part of the solution, I think, and it'll be more so if we go ahead where we have already identified the possibility of growth without employment. That's the basic idea that since 10 years ago started to be very strong. Most of the indicators of economic growth don't coincide with the growth of employment, unless, or sometimes they coincide, but with low-skilled type of labor. That's the case of the United States. All the growth of employment is low-skilled type of employment, is McDonald's type of employment. The problem now is raised with robotization, the robots. Because I think that in 20, 30 years, most of our firms around here in services, in technologies, in manufacturing will be based on robots. That's what they are producing now. And the reason why I was saying that the Ford was complying with Trump, because they know that they are not going to invest employment, they are not going to Mexico, because after all, was not such a good investment, because now they have moved to robotization. And once you move to robotization, it is much better to be in the United States than to be in Mexico because of the maintenance and of the robots and so on. So if more and more human labor is going to be displaced from fossil production, of course, robots can be made by robots, but not infinitely. Someone has to think about the first robot that makes all the others. I think that we have to find a new way of guaranteeing citizenship. Because labor, for one century, labor was the access to citizenship for most people. So the workers didn't vote when the liberals, even Cromwell, it's very interesting, after the Great Revolution in the UK, the workers could not vote because they were dependent on their employers. So they could not, like women, they were dependent people. Only, in fact, the landowners could be really the voters. So, but then they, through struggle, they managed to have rights, and through worker, trade unions, labor parties, and so on, they managed to access to citizenship through labor, labor with rights, basically, right? Now we have two movements, labor without rights, precariat, and labor without humans, robotization, particularly for the highest paid labor. That will be to the robots, most probably in the future. That's what all the labor futurists say. In that case, what is the access to citizenship? Universal income. We have really to go to universal income, funded by taxes, basically, and to be that the base of citizenship. The problem now is that we are at a monster. Even this public basic income is a monster in Gramscian terms. Because since we are in a transition, some countries have advanced to a basic income, like my country, but does not allow people to go above the poverty line. Okay. That is to say, it's not basic income. You want to keep them poor, so go to work, right? So this is not. But I think that the trend in the future will be something like that. That would be the task for socialists, for social movements, for trade unions, to fight for basic income, and I think it's a great proposal. Society is always solutions, but will take some time.
I'd like to open the discussion to the public. Is there anyone who would care to ask a question? And please shout a bit. Please.
Thank you. My question is your idea about a law of new dignity. How do we start thinking about this new approach, like imagine a new theory to think about the matters that you raise, about this post-abyssal law? If all the categories and all the concepts that we use in our thinking are derived from the old discourse. Mm-hmm. So that is my first question. My second question is about the revolutionization of democracy. How do you see the role of dispute resolution and courts and their role in democracy in the post-statist context? Mm-hmm. In your idea of the plurality of the state?
Well, I think that, as to the first question, I think there will be a time in which we are going to ask new questions based on old concepts, because that's typical of any transitional period, and I think that we are in this time of monsters in a transitional period. So, we cannot even be very consistent because what the concepts that we use, what we see is a kind of a disquietude about old concepts, about the new old forms of scholarship, about our curricula of our universities. And I see it everywhere, popping up here and there. There is something, and usually the students are the first ones to sense that something has to be changed. For instance, two extreme cases, so that we understand that the new forms of scholarship have to be invented to accommodate the new realities. South Africa. Well, the big debate today in South Africa is decolonizing the university, because the black students had access to the university, but the heroes of the, those universities, the professors are whites, the history is whites, the heroes of South Africa are the people that assassinated black people. So, and the people don't like that. So they want to decolonize the curriculum there. It's a big issue and very violent at that. I mean, it's almost out of control. For a period, it was almost out of control, and the police brutality, but also very many excesses on the part of the students there. And for instance, burning buildings and things like that, right? But we can see the disquietude of the students that are at a university that has the name of the guy that in fact subjected the blacks to the apartheid, Rhodes, in the beginning. I mean, the colonizer, and then the Rhodes University is the most famous one. Now the statue is not there anymore, they are changing the name, but changing the names is not enough. It's changing the curriculum. Because our history, for instance, the history of the winners told by the winners of the world. Never the losers never arrive to our books in history. But the other example is what is happening at SOAS, at London School, at the University of London now, the South Oriental and African Studies School. The students are have a new program called Decolonizing Our Minds. What do they want? In a sense, I have to say, a little equivocal way, I would say, but what they say is that we only learn about white European philosophers. They are male and pale, as they say, right? And there is nothing else. And some of them would really even like not to have Kant or Hegel or whatever, but most of them really have a very good reason for that, because in my work, I work with philosophers from Africa, from Asia, and lots of philosophers. If you go to my page of the Alice Project, www.alice.so, we can go there. I have world conversations with philosophers, and I decide, because of that prejudice that we think that the only philosophy worth of the name is Greek philosophy, right, even though there are lots of problems with that, I had a conversation with two great philosophers from Africa, Professor Valentin Mudimbe from Congo, and now in the United States, and Professor Mogobe Ramoza. Both of them trained in Louvain, Lanef, so here. Well, they are both black African philosophers with very opposite views. So the idea that African philosophy is the same, no. They are very diverse philosophy. Why these philosophers don't come to our curriculum? Only the old philosophers. In my course, I teach only at PhD level, but in sociological theory today, I teach side by side with Durkheim, Weber, and Marx, and Marx, which I think they are fabulous theoreticians. But I have to understand this: these five men or four men were all Europeans that were concerned with Europe. How could they really account for the rest of the world? So I have another founder of the social science that has been sometimes scandalous, but is absolutely obvious when you read his work. Is Ibn Khaldun is a great Islamic scholar from the 14th century, born in 1332 in Tunis, that wrote Mukaddima, the prologue to universal history. It's not a religious work. Is a secular work, because Ibn Khaldun distinguished between the revelation sciences and the observation sciences. And more serious and more, for me, anxiety-raising is that our man Durkheim knew about this work, used this work, and never cited him. The concept of solidarity, organic solidarity in Durkheim, comes from Asabiya, which is a key concept of Ibn Khaldun, but he never quoted them. So the West, you know, as we were extracting natural resources, we also extracted knowledge a lot from other continents. So I think to review the scholarship, we need to do this. And usually that's my point, is not to be, we have to know very well the Western tradition in order to be able to criticize it. Many people don't know it very well and make caricature. Of course, the Western tradition is not just these authors. I keep mentioning Spinoza, Nietzsche, you know, Schopenhauer, others, Las Casas, Vittorio. So there are so many other names that are part of this tradition. So I think that the Western tradition is more diverse than you have. And I think in one of my books, I have a chapter, Is There a Non-Occidentalist West? There is another West within the West. I think we should learn. And we should learn the others. About the revolutionized democracy, basically, what is democracy? Democracy, for me, is very simple. The transformation of unequal power relations into power, into relations of shared authority. Transformation from unequal power relations into relations of shared authority. This is valid for the family, for your friends at university, for your community, for your enterprise, and for the civil society and for our public sphere. The problem is that we use democracy just for the public sphere. The rest is despotism. Despotism at home. How do women suffer so much despotism in our societies still today at home? There's not democracy in the family, much less in the firm, much less in the communities when people in fact are afraid of going at night. My students, black students now in the United States, they don't go out alone at night. We are talking about medicine, black students. And some of them are from Mozambique, from Nigeria, from so on. But police is a black guy, is a suspicious guy. Immediately ethnic profiling all day. So I think that we have to democracy on our streets also, right? And of course in the political system. But what I can see is that it is shrinking. Even at the political level, democracy is shrinking. So I think courts should play a very important role here, and they should be playing that role. But they have been more democratically accessible. You have a very fine system. In fact, we have a former Minister of Justice. I have to tell you that I'm the director of the Permanent Observatory of Justice in Portugal. And we have a very good agreement with the colleagues here in Holland that they've been doing the justice in the courts and analyze the courts. We have been trying to copy some of your systems here because they are very good. For instance, in fight against corruption, for instance, what we call complex crimes and so on. You in your country, they have, for instance, in my country, is a scandal. The people that are powerful, they never go to court, and if they go to court, they are not punished. And sometimes we have now a former prime minister that has been detained. But we don't know. The courts are very low, very bureaucratic, and I think the courts should be trained in human rights and in democracy. I have studied courts for all my life, and what I'm really thinking is that the independence of courts is a bureaucratic independence. No, it's not a democratic independence. So they are more concerned about their privileges than about their duties in our society. I think the training at the law schools, the training in the academies of judges and magistrates, they have to change in view to make them more sensible in labor law, in administrative law. Administrative law is the law in which the citizens enters in contact with the state. Can you imagine that in my country, sometimes a problem or a case on an employer, state employee, and with the state takes 5 years to be solved? This is a negation of human rights, of citizenship rights. It's a negation of justice. So I think courts should do a lot, but they are very comfortable. Our courts sit in comfort zone, and they don't like to go outside, to go to that area. And even though... that's why it is interesting, Rob, to see the experience outside. A federal judge in Brazil just finished the PhD with me, and it's a fabulous PhD dissertation. He's a federal judge. And what they do, they have what they call the ambulant justice. They take a huge van, because we are talking about Brazil, a huge van with the magistrate, with the judge, with the attorney, with the secretary, and go to the favelas and stay every week, one day. People have open access for information about law, about their rights, to solve some of the cases. It is, unfortunately, it's in Portuguese, so you can't read it, as I can't read your work in Dutch. But it is really fabulous how the courts felt the need that the federal courts were so far away from the needs of the people that they decided to go inside, and now they have very interesting initiatives. So the courts have a potential, enormous potential, but they need political pressure to do so.
Thank you. I'd like to close today's session by giving Ralph a chance to tell us about his project with Quiet.
So
So my question about charity and the role of the richest people, I keep it for the bottle. So that, because you'd mentioned also the question about rich people who, the six richest people in the world who get charity. And in Holland, and I think you can compare it with the United States, that more charity is by particular people. And here in Holland, I think it's going the same way. But you said in your speech, it's not the good way. Or did I?
Well, it's not a good way. It's better than nothing. But I would prefer that people who have rights would not be dependent on these foundations, because usually they are not just out of generosity. It's a tax-deductible type of income. Okay. Many of these billionaires pay almost no taxes because of this. So it's not generosity. I would prefer that. But if the rights are being eroded, then our politicians don't know how to restore rights. Better than nothing, of course.
But I found some millionaires who are giving from the heart and not for the generosity. For them. I will tell it.
Save that.
I have to translate the quiet. The quiet is in English. I'm one of the founders of the Quiet 500. It's a parody on a Dutch magazine. What is every year the quote 500, is the Forbes 500, in where the 500 richest people, and in Holland you have the quiet the quote 500, with the, and it was with a Dutch writer, Anton Doutzenberg, here in Tilburg, a friend of mine. He came with the idea, we're going to portrait people in poverty on the same way, on the same glossy way, as people normally in the rich people, with the... We also paradise the advertisement. And I have one specially for the professor, one of hope, with the normally the perfumes and so on. So we send this magazine to all the 500 people, the rich people of this. We find ourselves the addresses, because normally they are secret. And we put a letter with it. And not you are bad and we are good. No, you have talents. You are successful. You have you successful in business. Come and join us. If you want to join us, you can give us money. But we want to. And two of them, they came to me here in Tilburg West, in my office in the neighborhood, and they came with a plan. And now in Tilburg, we're building quiet communities where we connect people in poverty with people who have. Get it better. And in Tilburg now, it's a starting project, a startup, and all kind of cities have, they want to adopt it. And now, this year, we have sent it again to new millionaires, and now we're new millionaires are getting together. So we want to close the gap between rich and poor. And this is only a small way, but we're selling this magazine, and on the day of poverty, 17 October, we launched, and we had all the news items, and you can still buy it, because the obranks, the proceeds are going to people in my areas who have visions of ideas of bottom-up projects. So this is my hobby, this is not my work, and the first one I give to you. And maybe I have to translate it in English once, because every time you get people from abroad, say, oh, that's nice. So quiet, it's the name also with the shame of poverty. But we make it a strong market. So a lot of people in Tilburg, they know it, and a lot of people in the Netherlands know it. So it's still to buy here. You don't have to do it. You may give it. But this is a little kind of hobby with some... Now, I gave it to you.
Thank you.
I should leave.
Thank you.
So for those of you who would like to purchase a copy, there will be some available outside in the foyer. Okay, I'd like to thank Professor Santos for a fantastic and very inspiring presentation. But of course, we would also like to give some gifts. And after the gifts, we will have a chance to have some drinks outside for those of you who want to join us. Of course, some stroop waffles in a Dutch. For those of you who don't know, of course, you would be happy to know this. Apparently, Delft Blue is originally from China.
Thank you very much, Connie, for your question and for your participation.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you so much. Gentlemen.
Guys, now.
Please.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh. Thank you, Al. Oh, no.
And I'd once again really like to thank Anneke, Jacoba, and Marianne for their fantastic help. It would, there's so many hours of work that go into 2 hours which remain invisible. That's not a sociology of the of absence and the invisibility, but it is certainly the labor invisible, which I would like to thank them for. See you in a bit.